Now that we've discussed endurance limits and mentioned that the endurance limit SE prime is 1/2 the ultimate tensile strength if ultimate tensile strength is less than or equal to 200 kpsi or SUT less than or equal to 1400 MPa. All of those endurance limits were collected for smooth, polished, standard test specimens. So these are ideal test specimens, but the real world does not have ideal samples. And so we have to correct that endurance limit by calculating a corrected endurance limit that depends upon all of these factors in here, which are called Marin factors. So what are they? Ka is the surface condition modification factor. Kb is the geometric size correction factor. Kc is the load correction factor. Kd is temperature modification factor. Ke is how reliable do you want it to be? Kf is miscellaneous effects. And as I mentioned, Se prime is from the perfect ideal rotating beam test specimen. And we multiply that by all of these factors, if we need all of them, to calculate an endurance limit at the critical location of a machine part in the geometry and condition of service. Now, the surface modification factor, Ka, is directly related to how the surface was prepared. Stresses at the surface can be higher because there could be polishing marks at the surface, and that surface finish will have an impact on the local stress concentration factors that are associated with the fabrication surface finish method. So the surface factor, it turns out, is a function of the ultimate tensile strength and is given by equation 619 in the book. Higher strengths are more sensitive to rough surfaces. So what you do is you calculate this surface modification factor, Ka, by taking the ultimate tensile strength and you use some fitting parameters, A and B, depending upon the surface finish. Table 6.2 gives you an example of some of the surface finish correction factors, and it's important that you keep in mind that factor A, which is multiplied out front, depends upon whether or not your units are kpsi or metric, whilst the exponent does not depend upon what units are used, but the exponent and this factor A depend upon whether you have a ground surface, a machine surface, a hot rolled surface, or an as forged surface. So the best thing to do right now is to do an example of that, where we are going to calculate what the surface modification factor is. So we'll just copy the equation again. For a steel that has a minimum ultimate tensile strength, so the SUT for this material is 520 MPa. So right off the bat, if I were to ask you, what is your estimated endurance limit for an ideal round specimen in rotating bending made of this material? Well, you would say that the SE prime is 1/2 520 MPa, which would give us 260 MPa. So that's our SE prime. And now if we make this out of a machined material, then we can go here and look up the A and B factors. The A factor, since we're measuring in megapascals, is 4.51. And the B exponent is -0.265. So our Ka would simply be 4.51 times the ultimate tensile strength, that's 520 MPa, raised to the power of -0.265. And if you do that calculation, you will find that Ka, the surface modification factor, is 0.86. We don't need a lot of significant figures in here because these are estimates anyway. Now, if all we had to correct for was surface finish, then we could calculate our corrected endurance limit as the Ka factor times our SE prime. Well, that would just be this 0.86 times our SE prime, which we said was 260 MPa. And that gives me a fully corrected endurance limit of 224 MPa. That's how you use that correction factor. Now keep in mind, this is an endurance limit where you have now corrected for the surface finish, but you're still looking at a rotating bending sample. And you can construct a curve in the SN diagrams so that you could predict the number of cycles to failure and the high cycle fatigue regime. Right, now there is another thing that occurs, and that is you create a geometric size effect based upon the diameter of your sample. The geometric size correction factor depends whether you're measuring diameters in millimeters or inches. And there's two different regimes of diameters. From roughly a tenth of an inch to 2 inches, you use this equation. Between 2 and 10 inches, and 10 inches is one heck of a large diameter, you would use this equation for the geometric correction factor. And in metric units, you would use these two equations. So this only applies for round rotating diameter specimens. If you're loading axially, meaning if you're not doing rotating bending, you do not use a geometric size effect correction factor. In fact, you just set KB equal to 1. So there's something interesting that we have to do here, and that is if we move from rotating, so this, let's imagine we have a shaft here, which is rotating about its center line. So we have some rotation going on, and it is exposed to bending. Then you know that if you took an instantaneous snapshot of that sample, you would have a bending stress that varied linearly from top to bottom. The bottom side would be in tension, given the way I drew the moments here, and the top side would be in compression. And that the maximum bending stress, sigma bend max, would be given by M times Y, which is D over 2, if D is the diameter of the shaft, divided by pi D to the 4th over 64. We've done this a lot of times. This is just 32M over pi D cubed. So the next question we have to ask is, well, rotating bending is great. All of our SN diagrams are associated with rotating bending. But what if we don't have a rotating bending specimen? What if we have a specimen that's loaded in axial tension? Or if it's not rotating and it's just loaded in cyclic bending? Well, this is where that geometric size correction factor shows up. It shows up because the stressed volume, the KB term, is a stressed volume correction. What that means is you have a volume of material that is exposed to the cyclic loads that are probing that material for favorable slip planes to get dislocation motion back and forth in the variable stress field. The higher the stressed volume, the more likely you are to find a defect that you can then nucleate into a crack. Now, if the sample is not rotating, what you need to do is you need to calculate the area in the equivalent rotating sample that's associated with a rotating sample. Area associated with 95% of the maximum stress. So if you go back to this bar, you're looking at, this is the max stress right here, and you're looking for the 95%, 0.95 sigma max, and you're looking at an onion skin of material. If you do the calculation for that, you find that the 95% stressed area for a rotating round section is about 7.7% of the square of the diameter. So that's an equation that gives you the 95% stressed area. And what you want to do when you have a non-rotating sample or a sample of a different sort of geometry is you want to equate the 95% stressed area to this stressed area so you can find an equivalent round rotating diameter D sub E. So what you're trying to do is you're trying to take a sample that is either not in rotating bending or has a non-circular cross-section, and you're trying to convert that sample into an equivalent diameter rotating bending specimen. So you're trying to convert whatever sample you have, suppose you had a rectangular cross-section, trying to convert that into an equivalent rotating sample. So the way you do that is by using a bunch of tables. Well, 6.3 from the book allows you to calculate for the equivalent diameter of a non-rotating, these are common non-rotating structural shapes. So now if we have a bar that has a circular cross-section and we're just exposing it to cyclic bending, we have to convert that to an equivalent diameter bar. So if this has a diameter D, the equivalent diameter of a rotating bending bar, so now this one would be rotating and exposed to bending, gives you that equivalent diameter. If it is a rectangular cross-section as shown here, and it's subjected to cyclic bending but not rotating, its equivalent diameter is given by this equation. In this case, its equivalent diameter is given by this equation, but it depends upon the axis about which you are applying the cyclic bending. So remember, all of these in table 6.3 allow you to calculate equivalent diameters for non-rotating structural cross-sectional areas. So here's what we're going to do. This is an example again from the book where we have a steel shaft loaded and bending. It is 30 millimeters in diameter, but it has a filleted shoulder that's 38 millimeters in diameter. The shaft material has an ultimate tensile strength of 690 NPa, and it wants us to estimate the Kb factor if the shaft is used in a rotating mode and in a non-rotating mode. So for rotating bending, we simply use the appropriate equation in the metric dimensions. We use one of these two equations. Well, if we have a diameter of 32 or 38 millimeters, we're going to be using this equation right here. Equal to 1.24 times the diameter raised to the minus 0.107 power. Now, we have to think about this for a minute before we jump to any conclusions, and that is there is a filleted shoulder, and we jumped to a new diameter. We went from 32 millimeters to 38 millimeters. Now, you know the worst case stress state is going to be at the fillet. And so we need to find the bending stress that's associated with the 32 millimeter section. And then later on, we'll figure out how we multiply that by a stress concentration factor to establish the stresses associated with this. So the higher stresses are in the 32 millimeter section. Before we go over the shoulder, you know that our highest bending stresses are going to be in the smaller diameter section. So if this is rotating and exposed to rotating bending, then you know we need to find the geometric correction factor, Kb, for the 32 millimeter section. So Kb is going to be equal to 1.24 times the 32 millimeters raised to the power minus 0.107. So that Kb factor is just going to be equal to 0.86. Now, the next part of the problem asked us to solve for the geometric size correction factor, Kb, for a non-rotating mode sample. So if we are no longer rotating that shaft, we have to first find the equivalent DE for the non-rotating section. And the section we care about, we already said, is the 32 millimeter diameter section. So we got to find an equivalent diameter for a non-rotating 32 millimeter. We go back to the table and we see that that equation is 0.37 times D. So we say our D equivalent is 0.37 times 32 millimeters, which gives me an equivalent diameter of 11.84 millimeters. So what you find is that when you're not rotating the 32 millimeter shaft, the stressed volume is lower. So the equivalent rotating shaft is of a smaller diameter. Now we have to calculate the geometric size correction factor for this. And we've already said that we're going to use this equation right here, 1.24 times the diameter to the minus 0.107. So you have 1.24 times the diameter, 11.84 millimeters, raised to the power minus 0.107. So my geometric size correction factor for the non-rotating 32 millimeter shaft is going to be 0.95. So we're going to have a correction factor that is now larger than it was for the rotating sample. It makes sense because we do not have to knock down the endurance limit as much when it's not rotating.